إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. My talk today is about the story of Genesis. The story of Genesis. And what is Genesis? Genesis is the English word for the beginning of creation. How were we created? And how did we come on this earth? And what happened when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our father Adam and our mother Hawa? And the story of the Genesis, so the story of Adam and Hawa, is a central theme of the Quran. It is one of the most oft repeated stories in the Quran. It is repeated in explicit detail at least 6 times and indirectly at least 12 times. And the story of Adam and Hawa and also their interactions with Iblis is a story that has so much moral benefit, so much wisdom in it for us. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continually repeats the story. And I'm going to actually summarize for you a much longer class that I taught, around 10 hours long. This was a class, actually more than 10 hours. And I'm going to summarize as much as I can for you, and basically, I think it's less than an hour and a half we have. So we're just going to give you some overall benefits that I have compiled and you know others have compiled before me. And we begin by talking about the process of the creation. How was Adam created? What was the methodology of the creation of Adam? And if we look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions 5 sources for the creation of Adam. That Adam is created from 5 apparently different materials. The first of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that Adam was created from, which one is it? You want this one to go higher. Okay, no problem. That Adam was created from water. And Allah mentions this in multiple verses. Of them is Surah An-Nur, verse 45. That Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. We made everything from water. And specifically for man, Surah Furqan, verse 54, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ مِنَ الْمَاءِ بَشَرًا. He is the one who created from water, man. So, one of the components of Adam's creation is water. Number 2 is turab. Allah mentions that Adam was created from turab. And turab is dried sand. Turab is dried sand. And this is mentioned 7 times in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, for example, that وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ تُرَابِ. And this is Surah Rum, verse 20. Of His miracles, He has created you from turab. So we have water and we have ma, we have turab. Number 3 is ard. Allah says we have created man from ard. And ard is basically soil. Ard is soil. Ard is also anything on the top of the land is called ard. So any topsoil is called ard. So you have different types of ard. But anything that's on the top of the world is called ard. And Allah mentions in 2 verses that He has created us from ard. أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. Allah says, I created you from ard. So this is 2 times in the Quran. So we have ma, turab, and ard. Number 4, we have teen. Teen. And teen is typically translated as clay. Teen is typically translated as clay, but in reality, teen means a mixture of water and sand that is malleable. You know, like Play-Doh, like the kids play? This is like that type of mixture is teen. So Allah mentions in multiple verses that He has created us from teen. Inna khalaqnahum min teenil lazib. We created you from sticky teen, teenil lazib. Lazib means if you use your hands on it, it's going to stick to it. It's malleable, just like, as I said, Play-Doh. So Allah specifically says, I created you from teen that is sticky, that is malleable. And perhaps teen is one of the more common sources mentioned in the Quran. So when Allah Azza wa Jal says to the angels, I am creating, He says, Inni khaliqum basharam min teen. I am creating a man from teen. And again, many other verses mention teen. Number 5, we have salsal. Number 5, we have salsal. And Allah mentions this in a number of verses. For example, Surah Hijr, verse 28. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِّن صَلْصَالٍ مِّن حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونَ. When your Lord said to the angels, I am creating man from salsal. What is salsal? Salsal is actually a noise. Salsala is a noise. It is the noise that is made when you knock on some hard surface. That's like salsala. And it's from, salsala is supposed to sound like that. reverberation. And salsal is the type of clay that when it becomes solid, you can knock on the clay and you will hear it reverberate. This is salsal. So salsal is a type of dried clay. And Allah says, I have created a man from salsal, from hama'im masnoon. And I will mention what that is in a while. In another verse in Surah Rahman, which all of you inshallah know this verse, that Allah says that, I have created man, خلق من صلصال كالفخار, created man from salsal that is like fakhar. And fakhar is a type of salsal, obviously, because Allah is saying salsal like fakhar. Fakhar was the type of teen that the potters would use. So you know, you've all seen pottery. Some of you have probably participated in pottery classes. So when you have the potter's clay, you have that clay that you use on that round thing that you go, it goes round and round. This is fakhar. So Allah is saying, I created man from salsal just like fakhar. Just like fakhar, this is what was used. And hama'im masnoon, which is also used by salsal, min hama'im masnoon. Hama'im masnoon, hama is a dark hardened clay. Masnoon means it has been changed. Sunnah means to do. Masnoon, it has been done. Masnoon, it has changed. So the word masnoon gives away that there is no contradiction in these five terms. Rather, there is an evolution of the terminology. That at one time it was tin al-lazib, it was salsal, it was fakhar, it was hama'im masnoon. So different stages have gone over the creation of Adam alayhi salam, and we put all of this together and we say that in fact there is no contradiction. Man has been created from two primary components, turab and ma, water and dried sand. When you put it together, you have different mixtures. And Allah references those different mixtures when He talks about teen, when He talks about salsal, when He talks about ard. These are all different mixtures of the water and the sand. So there is no contradiction. If somebody says, oh, your Quran mentions five different sources for the creation of Adam, we say no. Allah mentions actually two sources, water and sand, and then He mentions three terms that talk about different compositions of water and sand. Is that clear? Right? So there's no contradiction whatsoever. Also, we learn from the hadith literature of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خلق الله تعالى آدم من قبضة قبضها من جميع الأرض. Allah created Adam from a قبضة, and a قبضة for us is to take something and hold it, one handful. And in the case of Allah, we do not know what it is. But in our case, if I were to take some soil and pick it up, this is a قبضة. So our Prophet ﷺ said, Allah created Adam from a قبضة, from a fistful that He gathered from all of the earth. Bits and pieces from the whole world, He gathered it. قَبَضَهَا مِنْ جَمِيعِ الْأَرْضِ. And so, the hadith goes on. The children of Adam come according to the ard. Some of them are red, some of them are white. Some of them are black, some of them are in between. Some of them are easy and soft, like the soil. And some of them are filthy and pure. And some of are filthy and impure. And some of them are in between. So, this beautiful hadith reported in Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, our Prophet ﷺ said, Allah created Adam from the topsoil. And He created Adam from different types of topsoil. And He then said that the color and the quality of man is represented in the soil. And it is amazing if you look at the skin colors of mankind, you will find soil exactly of that color. You don't find any skin color of a man except that the soil has that skin color. And you will never find a man with a skin color that is other than the skin color, or that other than the color of the soil. There is no man that is green. There is no man that is yellow, that is blue. If you look at our skin colors, right, it basically goes from the sands, the beach of the sand, if you like, you know, the Seychelles sand, if you like, that, you know, that whitish sand, all the way to the different, you know, shades of brown and the shades of white, and then all the way down to a dark color. This is the shades of the skin of man. And that's exactly what our Prophet ﷺ said, that is why some men come in this color, some men come in that color. Also, the quality of people. So the Prophet ﷺ said, some of them are soft and easygoing, like the soft soil. Some are hard and harsh, like the hard soil. Some are pure, fertile, nice people. Some are filthy, khabith, disgusting. All of this, again, like there are soils, you look at it, you're like, you don't want to step in that. So just like the soil has different qualities, so too we have qualities as well. And in one hadith in al-Bayhaqi, similar to what we have just said, our Prophet ﷺ said, Allah created Adam, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى آدَمَ مِنْ أَدِيمِ الْأَرْضِ. Allah created Adam from the adim of the earth. And the adim means the top layer. And according to one opinion, we'll come to it, the word Adam comes from adim. What's one opinion? We'll come to that in a while. خَلَقَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى آدَمَ مِنْ أَدِيمِ الْأَرْضِ. Allah created Adam from the adim. And the adim, as we said, is the top layer of the earth. And so all of it, he said, it's black, it's red, and it's white. It's soft and it's pure, and it's harsh and it's arid. So all of this you will find in the children of Adam. All of this you will find in the children of Adam. This is in Al-Bayhaqi's Asma'i wa Sifat. And therefore, what we learn from all of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam from turab, then from the turab he made it into teen, then he left this teen, he left this malleable clay until it was hama im masnoon, then from the hama im masnoon he shaped him and he blew the ruh into him, then when he shaped and blew the ruh into him, this was the body of Adam alayhi salam. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explicitly told us this order and this methodology in one hadith narrated in the Musnad of Abu Ya'la, which is one of the more tertiary books of hadith. In the Musnad of Abu Ya'la, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى آدَمَ مِن تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلَهُ مِن طِين. Allah created Adam from turab, then he made him into teen. So from turab, he made him into teen. What is turab, by the way? Let's see, everybody remembers turab? Turab is? No, turab is? Dried sand. Then he made him into teen. So what was added? Water, right? So Allah created Adam from turab, then from turab he made teen. Then he left him until he was hama im masnoon. So the teen is left until it gets to another term used in the Quran. Then he shaped him and created him. So from the hama im masnoon stage, he was shaped. And he left him until he was salsalin kalfakhar. And that is the potter's clay that you can knock on it, right? So from malleable clay, it was left until it became hard, which is our skin. Our skin is no longer, you know, it's no longer fully malleable. It is salsalin kalfakhar. Then our Prophet ﷺ said, he left him there without blowing the ruh yet. And Iblis would pass him by. So there is the body of Adam without the ruh. Iblis would pass him by and say, you have been created for a great matter. خُلِقْتَ لِأَمْرٍ عَظِيمٍ. Meaning Iblis is feeling jealous that Allah wants something from you and I don't get this. I don't understand what's going on. You have a status that I do not have. So Iblis is walking around the body of Adam. And we'll talk about this again later on, but right now we're talking about the substance of the creation of Adam. And then our Prophet ﷺ said, Allah blew the ruh into Adam, and the first ruh that came in caused Adam to sneeze. When the ruh came into his body, and it tickled his nose basically, right? Because the ruh is going to go down, tickled his nose. So Adam sneezed. And as soon as he sneezed, he said, Alhamdulillah. And then Allah responded, Yarhamukallah, ya Adam. And the hadith goes on, but this is a very profound statement and hadith, and we'll come back to this again, inshallah ta'ala. But right now we're talking about the creation, but we then move on to, later on we'll talk about the benefits. If you really think about it, it's so amazing. The first words from the first man were Alhamdulillah. And the first speech that Allah gave to man was Yarhamukallah ya Adam. The first thing that Allah said to our father Adam. Another thing that we learned from the Quran, and this is well known to all of us, inshallah ta'ala, is that Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam with his hands. And of course, we don't delve into what this means and how this is beyond, but we believe Allah fashioned Adam with his yad, with his hand. And this is something that is explicit in the Quran, that in Surah Sa'd, verse 75, when Iblis refused to prostrate to Adam, Allah Azza wa Jal said that, why did you not prostrate lima khalaqtu biyadayya? to this being that I have created with both of my hands. He used the dual, yadayya, which is dual in Arabic, right? That مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ. Why would you not prostrate to a being that I have created with my both hands? Meaning, Allah has honored Adam by doing something to him that should make Iblis want to prostrate to him. Think about the context, right? I have chosen Adam in this manner and you have not prostrated to him. Why would you not do this? I have blessed Adam. How? خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ. So clearly, now there are some extreme groups that denied this, that they said, no, Allah did not create Adam with his hands. We cannot say this literally because, and they went into their reasons. But then subhanAllah, look at the context of the verse. Allah is rebuking Iblis. How dare you not prostrate? And he then mentions an honor that was given to Adam. And he says, to something that I have created with my own hands. And we have in the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, in the very famous hadith, which is called the hadith al-Shafa'ah. It's 5 pages long. It's one of the longest hadith of Bukhari. That on the day of judgment, all of mankind will go to Adam and beg him to start the day of judgment. Then they will go to Nuh. Then they will go to Ibrahim. Then they'll go to Musa. The hadith should be familiar to some of you. If it's not, then look it up. I don't have time to get into that hadith. But all of mankind will go to Adam. And they will beg Adam to go to Allah to start the day of judgment. And Adam will say, I committed a sin. Go to Nuh. I'm not capable of doing this. Go to Nuh. They will go to Nuh. Nuh will say the same thing. Go to Ibrahim. Go to Musa. Go to Isa. Until they will come to the Prophet ﷺ. And he will then fall down in sajda. This is the Maqam al-Mahmud. Now, when mankind will go to Adam, Sahih al-Bukhari, the phrase is as follows, that the Prophet ﷺ said, they will say to Adam, O Adam, you are our father. Allah created you with his both hands. Allah created you with his both hands, meaning you are such a noble person, why don't you start and beg Allah to start the day of judgment? So again, they praise him by saying, created him with your both hands. We also have another hadith in Bukhari and Muslim in the famous incident of Musa arguing with Adam. And I don't think we'll have time to get into this, but if we do, inshallah, we'll talk about it. If not, there's a hadith of the Prophet that he said, Musa and Adam argued in front of their Lord. Musa and Adam had an argument. This is in Barzakh. This is not in this world. This is in Barzakh. This is when the both of them have passed on. They had an argument with one another. And Musa said to him, to Adam, you are Adam, whom Allah created with his two hands. And Allah blew his ruh into you. And Allah caused the angels to prostrate to you. And Allah blessed you to live in Jannah. Then why did you eat of the tree and cause us to come down to this earth because of your sin? And the hadith goes on. Right, so we don't have time to get into, I don't think we'll have time to get, the hadith is the hadith of Qadr. So, and that's the issue of Qadr. We don't have time to get into that, unfortunately, today. But the phrase here, Musa says to Adam that Allah created you with his hands. So the evidence here is very clear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam with his hands. And there is an athar of Ibn Umar, a statement of Ibn Umar, it's not a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he said that Allah azza wa jal created 4 things with his hands. Allah honored 4 things by creating them directly. The rest of the things, he said, kun fayakun. And that is the creation of Allah. But there are 4 things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed above and beyond the regular creation by basically creating directly. What are these 4 things? Number one, Adam. Number 2, al-qalam. That is the pen. Number 3, al-arsh, the throne. And number 4, jannatu adn, which is the highest Jannah, right? So the Jannatul Firdaus is the one that Allah created with his own hands. And the rest of the world, he said, Allah said, kun fayakun. So this is now, please note, if you're right, taking notes now, this is not a hadith. This is a statement of Ibn Umar. However, learn this benefit here, that there is a maxim in hadith sciences that when a sahabi says something related to the knowledge of the unseen, then it gets a free upgrade to a hadith. When a sahabi talks about fiqh, it remains the statement of a sahabi. The fiqh position of a sahabi is not hadith, because it's his opinion about legal law. The theology of a sahabi, when he speaks about Jannah, Nar, creation of Adam, Allah's names and attributes, automatically it is given a free upgrade and it becomes a hadith. Why? Yes. Because there's no way that a Sahabi would know about the Malaika through his own thought. There's no way he would know about Adam through his own thought. Whereas fiqh, you can base on ijtihad. Halal and haram, you can think of the Quran and Sunnah and extract rulings from it. This is allowed. Fuqaha do this to this day. And the Sahaba did it from the beginning. So the ijtihad of a Sahabi is not hadith. But a statement of theology, of Jannah and Nar, of Adam, of the Day of Judgment, of the signs of the Day of Judgment. If, and this is only for the Sahabi. Anybody after? Obviously not. Sahabi could not speak about Allah Azza wa Jal because he thinks something. He must have heard it from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So when Ibn Abbas says that Allah created four things with his hands, sorry, Ibn Umar says Allah created four things with his hands, how can Ibn Umar say this? It's impossible for him to say this, except that he must have heard it from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay, so any statement of a Sahabi that is of a theological nature, we take it to a hadith. Okay, so Allah created Adam with his two hands. Where was Adam created? Where was Adam created? There are a number of opinions on this issue. There are a number of opinions on this issue. The first opinion is that he was created on this earth. Then he was taken up to Jannah. Then he came back to this earth. And this is the position of some of the early scholars of Islam, and their evidence for this is the Quran, Surah Baqarah, verse 30, that Allah says, "Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa." I am placing in this earth a khalifa. So they say Allah created from this earth, and also the ahadith that I've already mentioned, that Allah created Adam from adim al ard, that Allah took a qabda from the earth and created Adam. So perhaps it is as if they are saying that Allah created Adam on this earth. They extract from this hadith. And in fact, this is the position of the famous Indian scholar, Mullah Ali Qari. Mullah Ali Qari held the position that Adam was created on this earth. Then he was taken up to the heavens, and then the ruh was blown up in the heavens, and then he was asked to enter Jannah. And this is also the position of At-Tibi and other early scholars of Islam. Another opinion is that Adam was created in the skies, the samawat, and then told to enter the jannat. Now, pause here. I always go into this tangent because it's very important. There is the biggest misunderstanding that almost every lay Muslim has, and that is to mix up samawat and jannat. To mix up samawat and jannat. And many Muslims read the Quran and they confuse samawat with jannat. And the samawat are not the same as the jannat. Allah says in the Quran that He has created خَلَقَ سَمَاوَاتٍ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا. He has created seven samawat, right? Samawat are not the jannat. The jannat are what you want to enter, inshallah, in the next life. That's the goal. The samawat are the worlds, the galaxies or the constellations or whatever. And I don't have the time to go into the fancy word for this is Islamic cosmology, which means how Islam views the constellations, how Islam views the structures. But I reference you a lecture I gave, which is online. I have, as perhaps many of you know, I have an entire series on the seerah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is an ongoing series. I think I'm on 85 right now. And 80 what? See, I don't even know, 82. Okay, so I'm going to do 83 in 3 days, inshallah. I'll be doing 82 on this next Wednesday, inshallah. 83, and I don't remember the number, but the first episode of the Isra wal Mi'raj. I have, I think, 5 lessons on Isra wal Mi'raj. The first of those lessons of Isra wal Mi'raj, I go into a very detailed Islamic cosmological structure. How does Islam view the samawat and the jannat, and where are we, and where is the samawat, and where is the jannat? I go into all of this, so I reference you over there. But for now, all I'm going to tell you, samawat is not jannat. And when our Prophet ﷺ went to Isra wal Mi'raj, he went through the samawat, not the jannat. That's a separate thing. He went through the samawat. And when he saw Adam, and he saw Idris, and he saw these were not, he did not see them in Jannah. He saw them in the samawat. Okay, so for now we leave that. But the position, the second opinion, is the position of Imam al-Shawkani and also the great Indian scholar Muhammad Zakariya al-Kandahlawi, the famous muhaddith of India of the last century, that their position was that Adam was created in the lower samawat. Then he was asked to enter the Jannat. So the first opinion, he was created in the earth. Then he went up to Jannah. The second opinion, he was created in the samawat. Then he went into the Jannat. And their evidence is that the angels of the samawat, they prostrated to Adam. Then after the prostration, Allah said to Adam, "Uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah." Go ahead and enter, you and your wife live in Jannah. Which means they were not in Jannah when the angels prostrated to them. Because after the prostration, Allah said, go ahead, you and your wife enter Jannah. "Uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah." And this opinion is a very strong one. It is a very strong one, and it definitely has a lot of logical evidence. But there is a third opinion as well. And that third opinion is that Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam inside Jannah. Not on earth, not in the heavens, but in Jannah. And this is the position of Imam al-Qurtubi, the famous Andalusian scholar of the 6th and 7th century, and also al-Hafidh ibn Manda and other classical scholars of Islam. And their evidence is in fact very crystal clear. It is an explicit hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, narrated in Sahih Muslim, so there is no doubt about it, that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَمَّا صَوَّرَ اللَّهُ آدَمَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. When Allah fashioned Adam in Jannah, when Allah صَوَّرَ, fashioned Adam in Jannah, he left him as long as Allah wanted to leave him. And Iblis came and went around him, طَافَ عَلَيْهِ, and طَافَ means to go round and round, to see what he was. And he saw him to have a hollow cavity. He was empty from inside. And in one hadith, he entered and exited Adam. In another hadith, even more explicit, he entered from the mouth and exited from the anus. This is explicitly mentioned that Iblis did this. Then he said that I will always have control over a creation that cannot control itself. If I can enter you and exit you at will, then I will have control over you. Now, the hadith is about Iblis's control over Adam, but what is explicit here is that it says, لَمَّا صَوَّرَ اللَّهُ آدَمَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ, when Allah Azza wa Jal fashioned Adam in Jannah. And so this hadith is so explicit that it is fashioned in Jannah, and therefore we say then that in the face of this hadith, the other two opinions cannot be that strong anymore. When the hadith is that explicit, when Allah fashioned Adam in Jannah. So end of story, that this is the position that we have to hold, that Allah is, even though we say, of course, the other positions, we respect them, but it seems that when with this hadith is so explicit, then how do we understand the other ahadith? How do we understand the other evidences, excuse me, that Allah Azza wa Jal took the earth from all of the portions of this world? That's very simple. He took the earth and he took it up to Jannah. That's easy. How about the fact that Allah is saying, "Uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah." Go ahead and live in this Jannah. So the response is that the term uskun is not udkhul. Uskun means to what? Live. Go ahead and live here. And udkhul means to enter. So it is as if as soon as Adam was created and the angels bowed down to him, then Allah gave him permission to go ahead and wander in Jannah. Not necessarily to enter Jannah, because he was already in Jannah. So Adam is not told udkhul al-Jannah, Adam is told uskun anta wa zawjuka al-Jannah. Okay. Also, of the things that we know, is that Adam was created on a Friday. Adam was created on a Friday. And there are at least half a dozen ahadith that mention this issue, that Adam was created on Friday. And these are hadith in Bukhari and Muslim and many books many other books. Of them is the famous hadith of Abu Hurairah, the best day of the week is Friday. Today is Friday. The best day of the week is Friday. On it, Adam was created. And on it, he entered paradise. And on it, he was expelled. Notice, created, entered paradise, and expelled. And another hadith mentions that of the best of your days is Friday. On it Adam was created, on it he died, on it the trumpet is blown, and on it the qiyamah will happen. So notice all of these different blessings of Friday. And in one hadith it is mentioned that on it he was repented on, meaning he did his tawbah on Friday. Therefore, Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam on Friday. And when on Friday? In one hadith in Sahih Muslim, Allah created Adam after Asr on Friday, in the last of the creation, in the last of the minutes of the hours of Friday, in between Asr and the coming of the night, i.e. basically right now, basically at this time, in the very last time of Asr, this is when our father Adam was created. And the term Adam, does it mean anything or is it a proper noun? Where does the word Adam come from? And of course we know that even Christians and Jews say Adam. It's the same thing, Adam, and we say Adam, it's the same. They call the person the same, our father the same. Where does Adam come from? What is the name Adam? Many opinions. Number one, that the word Adam comes from the Arabic Adama, which means to join together, to join together. So it is as if Allah Azza wa Jal joined the turab and the ma, and he created Adam. And another position, number two, is that it is a skin color, because udma also is a skin color, which is a brownish color. So they say Adam was of a brownish color, and that is why he is called Adam. Another position is that there is no derivation. It is a proper noun, like Thomas or like whatever. There's no meaning for it. It is simply a proper noun. And the fact of the matter is that we don't know what is the origin of Adam, because when Allah named Adam, there was no language. And so can we say Adam comes from Udma? Can we say Adam comes from Adim? And that's another opinion. Adam comes from Adim al-Ard, as we said. Allah knows best. In the end of the day, we leave it to Allah, whether it is a derivation or a proper noun. Now, the next benefit that we get is that what are some of the wisdoms that Allah has mentioned for unifying the creation of man, for making man from only one person? And this is in contrast to what we know of the malaika and perhaps even the jinn. The malaika do not procreate. The malaika are not children and father and son and daughter, no. Allah created the malaika, each one of them. And as for the jinn, we do not have any evidence that there was one father of all jinn. And this is a common misconception that Iblis was the father of all jinn. No, there is no such evidence to say that Iblis was the father of all jinn. Not at all, not a shred of evidence. But for man, there is so much evidence that we are all descendant from one human being. So the point is that this interesting method of creation seems to be something special that Allah gave us. That all of us in this room, all of us in this neighborhood, all of us in this city, in this country, in this world, 6.5 billion people, we are all linked together somehow, and we all go back to one person. What are some of the wisdoms in that? Allah mentioned some of them. Of those wisdoms is the power of Allah Azza wa Jal demonstrated through the diversity of creation. Look around you. No two human beings are exactly the same. Even identical twins are not fully identical, and anybody who knows identical twins knows this. Even identical twins are not identical. No two human beings are exactly the same, nor have they been exactly the same from the beginning of creation until the end of times. And yet we are all the same, human. Isn't this absolutely amazing, phenomenal, beyond words, that no two people are exactly the same, and yet the origin is the same? No two of us think alike, look alike, dress alike. No two of us talk alike. We're all different in every way, yet we're all the same. We're human. What a miracle of miracles that human is one, humanoid is one, and yet within us there are so many differences. And Allah Azza wa Jal references this in the Quran, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, of his ayat. And whenever the Quran says of his ayat, it means of the signs of Allah's existence, of the signs of Allah's power, of the signs of Allah's names and attributes. Ayat here of the indications of who Allah is. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. Of the signs of the power of Allah, is that He created you from turab, thumma idha antum basharun tantashirun. Lo and behold, you are humans scattered everywhere. From one person, lo and behold, you are humans scattered everywhere. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Surah Ar-Rum, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, of His miracles, is خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ, and the fact that you have differences in your colors and your religions. Not religion, sorry, languages. اَخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ. You have different languages and you have different skin colors. So Allah is saying, your diversity of creation is a manifestation of my power. This is what Allah is saying, quite explicitly in the Quran. The fact that you are so varied, you have such different appearances, such different looks, personalities, languages, all of this goes, and you came all from one, all of this goes back to my power. Also, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions that of the wisdoms of unifying our creation, of having one common origin, is to cut off any sense of superiority based on lineage or tribe or race or skin color. How can anybody consider himself or herself superior to another based on a physical characteristic when all of these physical characteristics originated from the same source, right? Now, we living in, mashallah, tabarakallah, 2014 America, we take this for granted that all people are normal and equal, all people should be treated the same regardless of their features or their language or their ethnicity. We need to understand, nobody before our Prophet ﷺ preached this. Every race preached its own exclusiveness, its own elitist mentality. It was understood amongst mankind that every race felt itself superior to the other race. So the Persians felt themselves better than the Romans. The Romans said they were the superior. The Arabs felt, because they're the children of Ismail and Ibrahim, that they are the superior race. Every single race felt it is the best race and every other race is beneath it. And yet, you have an announcement.
Of course, what Islamic event is not amazing without a double parked car? YLP69H, someone really has to go, you're blocking them. Jazakallah khair.
So, of the benefits of the unified origin is the fact that it cuts off, as we said, pride of lineage, pride of skin color. And as I was saying, no theology, no philosopher, no thinker in pre-medieval times and ancient times ever said that all humans are the same. Not Aristotle, not Plato, not Confucius, none of them said this. It was understood by every philosopher that races are different, there's a hierarchy. And obviously, the philosopher would consider his own race to be the best race. It was a part of human understanding. So when our Prophet ﷺ came and he said, لا فضل لعربي على عجمي إلا بالتقوى. When he said there is no superiority of an Arab over an Ajam, there is no superiority of a white over a black, there is no superiority of a this over a that, this was novel. Now mankind has grudgingly, because we just saw last week some incidents in this country, right? Still deep down inside, racism is alive and healthy. Everybody knows this. We know this, especially as a Muslim community. Racism is in the hearts of many of them, right? But outwardly, it's politically incorrect, and they don't claim to be racist. So the fact of the matter is, this notion of all of mankind being the same in terms of ethnicity, no ethnicity is better than another. This is unique to our religion. And the Quran is explicit, and the hadith is explicit. And we should take great pride in this. And we can credit ourselves, we can credit Allah Azza wa Jalla's religion, but it is our religion that Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed to us, that for the first time said, it doesn't matter what your skin color is, what your race is, who your father is. It's all irrelevant. Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum. And this is explicit in the Quran. Ya ayyuha an-nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. O mankind, we created you from one man and one woman. Waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila lita'arafu. And we made you shu'ub. And shu'ub here means races. So there's the Chinese race, there's the Indian race, there's the Arab race, there's the African race. These are the races, shu'ub, sha'ab. And qaba'il, within the sha'ab you have qaba'il. You have the tribes. And in our times, tribal systems are almost gone from the face of the earth. Only a few societies are remaining tribalistic. But What has replaced tribalism is nationalism. What has replaced tribalism is nationalism. Rather than saying that I am Qurashi, I am Tamimi, I am Hawazin, I am Thaqif, we are saying I am Pakistani, I am Bengali, I am Indian, I am this and I am that. And even within Pakistan, we have the Muhajir and the Punjabis and this and that and all of this. So instead of qaba'il, what has happened is we have nationalities, right? And we are now taking our alliances via these nationalities. So we don't have those qaba'il that much, but we have rather the sectarianism. And Allah is saying, all of this, I have given it to you. It's okay as long as you use it for a legitimate purpose. لِتَعَارَفُ, get to know one another. Not so that you can impose yourself, not so you can be superior. Imagine if everybody was the same race. Imagine if everybody spoke the same language. Imagine if everybody's cuisine was the same. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. No biryani, my God. Wow. Where would we be? Right? Imagine if everybody's culture was the same. How boring. Well, I think honestly, how boring would life be? So Allah is saying, we created you, shu'uban wa qaba'il, so that there's some diversity. لِتَعَارَفُ. You can introduce yourself. You have something to talk about. Where are you from? What your ethnicity is? So this is okay. It's all halal. It's okay to have a generic pride in who you are and your ancestry, as long as that pride doesn't lead to arrogance and doesn't become more important than Islam. It's okay to be proud of your ethnic origin and heritage as long as that pride is within Islam. Islam is the ultimate loyalty. Everything else is secondary to that. So Allah said, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. And so notice here, by the way, Allah linked Adam and Hawa being one couple to all shu'ub and qaba'il being the same. It's an explicit linkage here. No sha'ab and no qabila is better than the other because you all come from the same origin. And this is even more explicit in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he said in front of the largest gathering that he ever spoke to in his life. The largest gathering he ever spoke to is Hajjat al-Wada'. 100,000 people were gathered in front of him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And what did he want to emphasize? He wanted to emphasize this message. As all of you know, he said in one of the paragraphs that, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind, Allah Azza wa Jal has gotten rid from you the fanaticism of jahiliyyah. The fanaticism of jahiliyyah. It's gone now. لَا فَضْلَ لِعَرَبِيٍّ عَلَىٰ عَجَمِيٍّ. There is no superiority of the Arab over the non-Arab or of the white over the black except through taqwa. Notice, he mentioned the two main reasons why people become fanatics in race. Number one is blood. Number two is skin color. Right? This is the two main reasons why people are racist. What are the two main things of racist? Is number one is blood. Right? Now the issue of blood has kind of dwindled down somewhat, but it is not fully dwindled down. And instead of saying my grandfather was so-and-so, we say that I am Punjabi or I am this. This is a blood. This is basically a bloodline, right? And number two is skin color, right? White skin color, black skin color, this skin color, that skin color. So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned these two things, Arabi, Ajami, and white over black. He mentioned this, that both of these things are ridiculous. And then he said at the end of this famous khutbah, Kullukum min Adam. Notice he linked. He linked equality of man with the notion of all of you are from Adam. Wa Adamu min turab. And Adam was from turab. How can you be boastful over one another when your origin is the sand that you're walking on? How can you be arrogant when the very sand that you walk on, this is where you came from? And the person you think is better than you, you think you are better than, he too came from the same sand. The both of you came from the same. So notice how frank our Prophet was, that all of you are from Adam, and Adam was from Turab. So this is some of the benefits and wisdoms that are mentioned. And one thing can also be added here, and that is knowing that every single person you ever meet in your life, knowing every single person you ever encounter in your life has some blood relationship with you. There's some blood relationship will automatically make you more concerned and care about them. There is something called the brotherhood of humanity. It's not an un-Islamic concept. There is something called the brotherhood of humanity. No doubt the brotherhood of Islam is the most important for us. But does this mean that the non-Muslim has nothing to do with me? No. Very explicit ahadith in this regard, the most famous one being the famous hadith of the Jewish person who died and his funeral procession was passing by, and the Prophet ﷺ stood up out of respect for him. And so imagine, everybody can see it's a Jewish procession, because the Jews have different styles of hair and dress. Everybody is seeing it's a Jewish procession. And everybody is quiet. Like even here in America, when the funeral is going, what happens? Everybody stops their car, you know, gets out of the lane. The police is going quickly. You know, there's a respect given to the body, right? And we show this respect. So the Prophet ﷺ was showing the respect in his time, which was to stand up and watch the procession go by. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, this is Yahudi. This is a Yahudi. As if he didn't know, by the way, as if you couldn't recognize, this is a Yahudi. And he said, wasn't he an insan? Wasn't he a human? Okay, he's a Yahudi, I know, but wasn't he a human? And Nawawi comments on this hadith, and he said, here the Prophet ﷺ was honoring or respecting him because of uhuwatul insaniya, the brotherhood of being a human. Yes, there is a Yahudi, but he is a brother eventually, somewhere back there. We all go back, right? So this demonstrates for us that the concept of human brotherhood, the brotherhood of humanity, it is something that, yes, it is an Islamic concept, and it should motivate us to be better to everybody. Because in the end of the day, everybody that you meet, somewhere back in your lineage, you have the same father. You have the same ancestor, whether it's two generations, whether it's five generations, whether it's 50 generations. But somewhere there was one family, and from that family, you and the other person. Somewhere there was one husband and wife, one child, you know, two brothers and sisters. From that, you are all coming. There should be a feeling of solidarity with every human being, and our religion explicitly encourages this. Okay, moving on to the next point. And inshallah, I'll talk for another half hour. Do whatever I can, and then we'll open the floor for Q&A, inshallah. Moving on to the next point. So Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam in Jannah. Allah Azza wa Jal fashioned Adam in Jannah. And Allah blew the ruh into Adam. نَفَخَ فِيهِ مِن رُوحِ. Allah blew the ruh into Adam. And this is explicitly mentioned in the Quran. فَإِذَا سَوَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِن رُوحِ فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ. So after I have fashioned him and blown my ruh into him, then fall into prostration. So Allah explicitly tells the angels that I'm going to create Adam. He's telling them before this is done, by the way. So he tells them, I'm going to create Adam. I'm going to fashion Adam. I'm going to blow the ruh into Adam. Once he is ready and prepared, you will prostrate to him. So this was told to the angels before the manufacturing of Adam alayhi salam. And therefore there is unanimous consensus amongst all of the Muslim groups and scholars that Allah Azza wa Jal breathed the ruh into Adam. Now, there is a misconception here that some of the extremist groups have, not the mainstream Sunni Muslims. There are some very extreme mystical groups, and they say that Allah Azza wa Jal breathed his uncreated ruh into Adam. And from this we get the notion that is found in some Far Eastern cultures as well, and we hear it to this day. We all have a spark of divinity within us. We all have a little bit of divine within us. This is not the belief of Muslims, mainstream Muslims. This is not the belief of Ahl Sunnah or Sunni Islam. Allah breathed ruh into Adam. The ruh was a created ruh. It was not the ruh that Allah Azza wa Jal has, and that's not what the Quran says. When Allah ascribes the ruh to himself, ruhi, he is ascribing the ruh to himself as he ascribes the Kaaba to himself, my bait. As he ascribes the Prophet, abdi, abdullahi, rasulullahi. This is an ascription of honor, not an ascription of attributes. So when Allah says, I blew my ruh into him, this ruh is a created ruh. It is not, astaghfirullah, we don't believe that we all have sparks of divinity within us. This is the Far Eastern philosophies. This is Far Eastern religions, they say, and you hear this still amongst some of the people in this world, in this part of the world, that we're all, you know, in the end of the day, divine. We all have that God within us. We don't believe this. We do not believe this, and astaghfirullah, this is kufr to believe. It's not a part of our theology. And some people of the far extremist mystical groups, they say when Allah says his ruh, so he means his ruh, literally Allah's ruh, uncreated ruh went into Adam. No. When Allah says his ruh, it is like Allah saying his house or his servant, which is a created ruh. And this is something that there is unanimous consensus over. There's unanimous consensus over this point. Now, one point here that we're not going to go into a lot of detail in this lecture, but I have gone into detail into many other lectures, and these are online, is the whole issue of Darwinism and Adam having been a metaphorical image or a parable is something that it is really impossible to believe if you believe in the Quran, frankly. If you believe in the Quran, then you really have a stark choice to make here. Either you believe in humans coming from basically evolution and whatnot, and you reject the Quran, or you believe the Quranic narrative, because there is no way to completely reconcile the two. However, I have given a modified theory, and it is not the time and place to get into it, but you can find this online. I have given two lectures I reference you to. One of them was given last year at ICNA, ICNA ICNA convention, and you can just Google Yasir Qadhi Evolution Talk ICNA, and it is a long talk, an hour talk where I summarize my views. There is a much longer talk, a debate that took place in London also last year, and this was a debate between Muslims who believed in evolution and between a panel, including myself, who didn't believe in it, and we went back and forth, and you can find this debate online. I presented a theory that I believe, inshallah ta'ala, salvages the facts of biology and also the explicit text of the Quran. And it is something that Allah knows best if it's true or not. But for sure, what is clear cut for us, we cannot understand the story of Adam to be a fable. We cannot understand the story of Adam to be a metaphor. Because if we say the story of Adam is a fable, is a story, this is exactly what the kuffar accused the Quran in هذا إلا أساطير الأولين. These are only fables and legends. Allah does not lie. Allah does not lie. And when Allah tells us in explicit detail, I created Adam, I fashioned Adam, I blew the ruh into Adam, I created him from tin al-lazir, from salsal, from this, from hama'im masnoon, that the angels bowed down, there is not a single shred of evidence that Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking in metaphors and in symbolic languages. And the sheer quantity of nouns and adjectives and adverbs about the creation of Adam, the sheer quantity of verses in a hadith, all point to the same narrative that there was an actual human being called Adam, and that he is the progenitor or the source or origin of all of us, and that is really something that the Quran is explicit about. At the same time, the theory of evolution can be adopted in other species. I don't believe there's any problem in saying that animals evolved. Not a problem at all. The Quran doesn't tell us that there was one origin of a chicken or a dog. No, the Quran doesn't say that. And if somebody believes this, we will say that's his opinion and business. It's nothing of the Quran. The Quran does not tell us that there was one prototype of the horse and all horses came from that. No, there's nothing like this. So if somebody wants to say the animals came from this mechanism and method, there is nothing un-Islamic about this. This is biology. Let them say this. But when it comes to human beings, we have to say no. Allah Azza wa Jal created us in a special manner. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. We have honored the children of Adam. And I've talked about this in other lectures. Now is not the time because we don't have time to get into the issue of biology and Darwinism. But it is online, and I reference you to my lectures online. The next issue that happened was Allah teaching Adam how to speak. Was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaching Adam how to speak? And Allah's speech to Adam. So Allah spoke to Adam and Allah taught Adam how to speak. There are a number of things here. Allah spoke to Adam. And there are many evidences, by the way, that demonstrate that Allah spoke to Adam. And this is an honor that Adam had that very few people had. In fact, we only know of two other people that had this honor. Musa and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In our tradition, we only have evidence for three prophets. Were there more? Maybe, we don't know. But the Quran and Sunnah tell us three prophets whom Allah spoke to directly without any intermediary. And that is a great honor. That is a great honor that was only given to Adam and Musa and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as far as we know. Maybe there were others Allah did not tell us. As for the evidence of Allah speaking to Adam, there are many evidences for this. Of them is Allah speaking to Adam, وَقُلْنَا يَا Adam. We said, O Adam, أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah is saying, O Adam, you and your wife live in Jannah. Which clearly shows Allah is speaking to Adam. And also, فَتَلَقَّ آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ. Adam learned some words from his Lord. Adam learned some words from his Lord. And also when Allah sent Adam down, Allah says in the Quran that قُلْنَا اهْبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا. We said, the two of you go down. And when Allah is saying we, He is meaning Himself, right? So Allah is speaking directly to Adam. And also in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentions that when Allah blew the ruh into Adam, the ruh reached his head. And when it reached his nostrils, he sneezed. And he said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So Allah responded back, Yarhamuka Allah Ya Adam. So there's a direct speech. Yarhamuka, in the singular. Yarhamuka Allah Ya Adam. So these hadith are very explicit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Adam. We also learn that Adam alayhi salam was created in a much larger shape than we are in our times. And this is a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, the most authentic books of hadith, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى آدَمَ عَلَى صُورَتِهِ وَطُولُهُ سِتُّونَ ذِرَاعًا. That Allah created Adam in His image and his height was 60 cubits. This is a cubit. This is a dhira'. This is a dhira', right? What is the height of an average man? In cubits, please. Cubits? 5 cubits? Measure yourself. 4, 5, 6, okay. So the average human is 4 or 5 cubits, right? Adam was created sittuna dhira', 60 cubits. وَطُولُهُ سِتُّونَ ذِرَاعٌ. Adam was created 60 cubits. So Allah Azza wa Jal fashioned Adam in the, basically we'll call him like a giant, basically a massive structure. And then obviously we are no longer this tall. What happened? There are a number of theories, but perhaps the strongest one is that when Adam came down to this earth from Jannah, so he came into the size that he was in. And Allah knows best. This is one theory that is propagated, that he was 60 cubits in heaven because that's where he was created. When he came down to this earth, then he came into the regular size that we are, which is 4 to 5 cubits. Also, one of the interesting things that we learn from the creation is that when Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam, He extracted the children of Adam from Adam. He extracted the children of Adam from Adam. And this is an interesting point as well, that our Prophet ﷺ said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam, He rubbed his back, and from his back He extracted every single nasma, which is a soul, every single soul that would ever come from Adam. So when Allah created Adam, all of the other souls were created after the creation of Adam alayhi salam. And Allah Azza wa Jal scattered all of these souls in front of him. And he asked these souls, Am I not your Lord? Alastu bi Rabbikum. This is in the Quran now. This is in the Quran now. Surah Al-A'raf 178, I think 172, you can look it up. That Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Remember that day when Allah Azza wa Jal took from the children of Adam their progeny, and He asked them, Am I not your Lord? And they all responded, Bala, yes, you are our Lord. And this is called the Day of the Covenant, Yawm al-Mithaq, the Day of the Covenant. And some people call it the Day of Am I Not, Yawm al-Ast, Yawm al-Ast, the Day of Am I Not, because of this issue of Allah Azza wa Jal saying, Am I not your Lord? So Allah Azza wa Jal created the children of Adam, Allah created the souls of the children of Adam, after He created Adam. And therefore our souls, my soul and your soul, were created at that time. And then on the 40th day of conception, our souls came down, an angel brought them, and an angel blows the soul into the womb of our mothers. Look at the difference. Who blowed the soul into Adam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who blows our soul into our womb, into our mother's wombs? The angel is the one who takes it, and the angel then blows into the womb, right? And so the ruh goes into the soul on the 40th day, according to the strongest opinion, how many days it is. Some say 120, and some say 40 days. Another characteristic of Adam, so he was 60 cubits tall. Another characteristic of Adam was that he actually had a lot of hair on his head. Very hairy head. Some of us are scratching our heads wondering where those genes went. So Adam had a lot of hair, and this is proven in a hadith of Abdullah ibn Ahmad in his book Kitab al-Zuhd. He has a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Adam was a very tall man, as if he were a towering date tree. So he called him like a towering date tree, which is 60 feet tall basically, right? As if he was a towering date tree. And kathikana kathifa sha'r, he had a lot of hair on his head. So there's an explicit hadith that the Prophet ﷺ is saying he was a very hairy person. And another characteristic of Adam is that most of the scholars also say that Adam was extremely handsome, exceedingly handsome. Now there's no explicit evidence for this, but there's implicit evidence. There's no explicit evidence that the Prophet ﷺ said that Adam was extremely handsome, but there is implicit evidence. Of these evidences is Surah At-Tin, verse 4, that Allah says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We created insan in the best of all shapes and fashions. We created insan in the best of all shapes and fashions. And of the evidences is that Allah fashioned Adam with his own hands. Surely what Allah has fashioned with his own hands is going to be the most perfect and the most handsome. It's impossible to think that this would be mediocre then. When Allah created Adam with his own hands, perhaps some have said, and this is an opinion of As-Suhayli and other scholars of medieval Islam, that Adam was the most handsome human being ever. This is a position. The most handsome human ever created. And you will immediately say, hold on a sec. How come Yusuf alayhi salam is considered to be the most handsome? And As-Suhayli has already preempted you. And he has said, as for the hadith of Yusuf having been given half of beauty, this is half of Adam's beauty. He has an interpretation. This is an opinion. This is half of Adam's beauty. So Adam was double handsome Yusuf. And this is not something that is strange to think about, because when Allah has fashioned Adam, what do you think, you know, Adam will look like? And there are other evidences of this, but inshallah ta'ala, that is sufficient for this issue. We move on now to the next issue, and that is the issue of وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Allah taught Adam the names of everything. Allah taught Adam the names of everything. We all know this famous story. It is what is mentioned in the Quran, that we taught Adam the names of everything. Then we tested the angels. We asked the angels, do you know the names of these things? And the angels said, no, we do not. So what does this mean here? Again, many opinions, but for the purpose of this class, we'll summarize into two very simple ones. Number one, the first opinion. He taught Adam the names of a specific group of beings, the names of a subset, a category of beings. What were these? Many different opinions. Some say the names of the angels. Some say the names of his own children. Some say the names of the animals. Some say the names of the species, but not the animals. But the point is, he taught Adam some subset of names. This is the first opinion. The second opinion, he taught Adam language. Not just the names, he taught Adam speech. He taught Adam the nouns of everything. And in fact, this opinion is really the more logical one, because Allah says in the Quran that Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Qur'ana khalaqa al-insana 'allamahu al-bayan. And bayan means eloquent speech. Bayan means eloquent speech. So Allah taught Adam al-bayan. And al-bayan is eloquent speech. And what was this language? There are at least 15 opinions about what this language was. Aramaic, Hebrew, ancient Hebrew, Syrian, Arabic, some of our medieval Persian scholars even said it was Farsi that he taught. And I would not be surprised if some of our modern scholars said it was Urdu itself, mashallah. But the fact of the matter is that this is rather idiosyncratic because all of these languages came later on. All of these languages came later on. And perhaps the strongest opinion is that Adam was taught the mother of all languages that no longer actually exists. It was the original language, a language, and that language, it is now, this is my theory, take it or throw it out the window, it is my interpretation, that that language resembles Semitic languages. Because now, pause here, if you study linguistics, if you study the theory of languages, so this is an interesting topic in humanities, and that is studying languages. There's something called families of languages. Even languages are related. You have cousins and brothers and uncles and aunts amongst languages as well. Kidding a little bit, but you do have genealogies of languages, and languages go back together. So for example, English and French are cousins, really. You know, they're related to one another and they go back to similar languages, whereas English and Arabic are not directly related. They go back far, far back. Now, modern linguists say, this is a whole different tangent as I go into my tangents. Modern linguists say, and of them is Chomsky, who is well known to many of you, Noam Chomsky, the professor of political thought and languages at MIT. Chomsky's theory, and many theories, many theorists in our times, they say that all languages originated from one language. And they have charts that demonstrate this, that the modern languages that we have, they all are interconnected. And they go back to one original language. And this is something that they are deriving by examining languages here and there. And they're seeing patterns and evolution of languages. Languages evolve. This is something we all understand. If you look at even a black and white movie from the 40s, right? The way they speak English, we understand it, but we don't speak like that anymore. The accents, the terminology, the words, the emphasis, everything. Do I have to talk about Shakespeare? I mean, how many of you hated reading Shakespeare in high school or in college? Because you didn't understand a single word that's being said, because that's 500 years old. So languages evolve. So we can monitor, we can draw out, chart out languages, and modern linguists, they basically say, that, and this is the predominant, the understood theory, this is the main theory, and that is all languages go back to one language. And this is in fact exactly what the Quran will basically tell us as well, that Allah taught Adam that one language. And then from that language, all of these other languages came. And this is something that as well, modern linguists and anthropologists are very amazed about, that why did man develop language? No other creation developed language. Because from their perspective, we are an animal, right? From their perspective, we are like the other animals. So the question is, why then did man develop language and no other creation develop language? And they don't have an answer for this. They don't have any realistic answer. And for us, this proves for us the superiority of the creation of Adam. That Allah taught Adam how to speak. And if Allah had not taught Adam how to speak, we would be grunting and we would be just be pointing or speaking in monosyllables like the animals speak. Now pause here. Do the animals speak? Yes. How do you know this? Have you spoken to an animal recently? Suleiman spoke to the animals. Okay. Did our processor speak to the animals? Yes, he spoke to the animals, right? He communicated with them, right? And there are other ahadith that mention animals speaking to one another. And in modern times, we are trying to decipher the language of the animals. They have found, marine biologists have recorded whales communicating with one another from hundreds of miles away. They have recorded the sounds, and they have found patterns in the sounds. So one whale is communicating with another whale, and you actually find a similarity in pattern, i.e. a word is the same. Now the problem is we don't understand what they're saying because we cannot think like a whale, right? But they're trying to decipher what the whale is saying to the other whale. the ant says to the other ant in the Quran, enter your houses, Sulaiman will trample over you, right? And we know for a biological fact that ants can communicate with other ants where there is food, where there is danger. Now, how then do we understand that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَعَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ, even though the animals communicate? What is so special, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا, when animals are clearly communicating with one another? Who can tell me this? Yes. So the animal speech is limited. It is not bayan. Bayan is not mere kalam. Bayan is eloquent kalam. The animals can tell each other, food is here, danger is there. The animals don't have poetry. The animals don't have history. The animals don't have literature. The animals don't have Shakespeare. So, عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ is something specific only to us. And modern linguists, anthropologists, they are completely confused because it does not make sense in the grand scale of things. You see, another pause here. For those who believe in Darwinism and theory of evolution, there are certain things about us that are peculiar and are not found in any other species. There are certain things about us that no other species has. Number one in the list is language. Because there's no other creation that has language. And it doesn't make sense that if evolution were really true, then chimpanzees would have maybe 70% of language, right? Other species would have maybe 30% of language. It's not the case. We are the only creation that has this type of flourishing of language, right? And number two, the main thing that we have that no other creation has is the ability to think so profoundly and deeply. We can think how we think. We can think why we think. We can think about what we're thinking about. Think about that. We can think about what we're thinking about. This is called metacognition. There is something called cognition. It's hot. It's cold. There's an enemy. This is cognition. There's metacognition. And that is knowledge of your knowledge. This is a profound, if you like, analysis of your knowledge. This is history. This is literature. This is civilization. This is studying. Why are we studying what we're studying, right? The animal knows, I want food. I'm scared of an enemy. This is knowledge. But to analyze, why do I want food? Why do I want this type of food? What is good about this food versus that food, right? Where does the urge to have food come from? This is metacognition. We have this. No other creature has this. And again, biologists that don't believe in a God are scratching their heads like, why do we have these things? And of course, for us, it's very clear. Allah gave us an aql, and Allah Azza wa Jal taught us bayan. These things directly come from Allah. So obviously, we have what other creation does not have. So we move on now to the next point. Inshallah, we'll try to, oh my God, wow. Try to finish up whatever we can, then leave the floor for Q&A. The next point, the creation of Hawa. The creation of Hawa. The texts of the Quran and Sunnah are explicit that Hawa was created from Adam. The texts of the Quran and Sunnah are explicit that Hawa was created from Adam. That there was one soul, and from this one being, the second was created. And from the two of them, multitudes came forth. And perhaps the most explicit is the first verse of Surah An-Nisa. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. Sorry. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, what is the first verse of An-Nisa? Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida. O mankind, fear your Lord who has created you from one nafs. Wa khalaqa minha zawjaha. From this nafs, he created its spouse. وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And then from the two of them, he created multitudes of men and women. So therefore, there is unanimous consensus that Hawa is created from Adam. In Surah Zumar verse 6, خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ ثُمَّ جَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. Allah created you from one nafs. Then from the nafs, جَعَلَ زَوْجَهَا. He extracted or created its zawj. And therefore, it is something that anybody who denies this has denied the explicit testimony of the Quran. And of course, the Sunnah as well is mutawatir in this regard, that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned that Hawa was created from a dhil', from a rib of Adam. This is something that is muttafaq alayh. It is authentically narrated in the hadith literature that meant that the woman or the Hawa was created from Adam alayhi salam. And this is something that, how was this creation done? We don't really have any explicit text. All that we have is from the dhil', from the side of Adam. What, how, completely blank, and therefore it does not make any sense to try to extrapolate more when we don't know what is the case. Now, we also, before we move on to the prostration of the angels, we also can derive from the creation of Hawa. When was Hawa created? When was Hawa created? It appears, and it's not explicit, it appears that Hawa was created after the prostration of the angels to Adam. And whenever Hawa is mentioned, whenever the reference is given to the Zawj, sorry, the Zawja, of course Hawa is never mentioned by name in the Quran, but mentioned by name in the Sunnah. So the Prophet mentioned Hawa, but it is not, the name is not mentioned in the Quran. The Quran simply mentions his spouse, Zawjaha, the spouse of Adam. And whenever this is mentioned, it's always mentioned after the story of the prostration. So look at Surah Al-Baqarah. In Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 30 mentions the creation of Adam. Verses 31 to 33, teaching him the names. Verse 34, prostration to Adam. Then verse 35, we told him and his wife, go ahead and live in Jannah. So perhaps it is as if, and the same is Surah Al-A'raf, by the way, that verse number 11 is the creation of Adam, 12 to 18 is the story of Iblis and the prostration, 19 is you and your wife live in Jannah. Right? And the same for Taha as well, and other surahs over here. So it appears, therefore, that Hawa was created after the prostration and before the command to live in Jannah. Clear? After the prostration, then Hawa was created, and then the command to live. Now, this does not seem to, sorry, it seems to contradict the Christian or biblical perspective, which we don't really care about, I'm just saying it does seem to, in that the biblical narrative is that Adam lived a long time, all alone, bichara, miskeen person, and he wanted a companion, then Allah blessed him with a spouse, like many of our young brothers are struggling, so they can sympathize with that version of the story. But the Quranic narrative doesn't seem to suggest that at all. What does the Quranic narrative suggest? Before even Adam entered or lived in Jannah or was told to live in Jannah, there was already a spouse at his side. Right? Sorry, bachelors, but that's really the big thing. The case, Allah blessed Adam with Hawa instantaneously, basically. After the creation, after the bowing down, then Hawa was created instantaneously. And we can derive a somewhat romantic point with this, and that is that you can't enjoy Jannah without a spouse. So there's no Jannah on earth as well, but sometimes Jannah becomes Jahannam as well, but that's a separate point here. That we can derive here that the importance of a spouse, and on a serious note, wallahi, every one of you, inshallah, who has a successful marriage, and I hope all of you have successful marriages, you realize that, wallahi, without a spouse, you are not fully... you need a companion. You need a companion. And you don't enjoy... And this is mentioned in the Quran, basically, that وَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمُ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ, that you won't enjoy Jannah without having Hawa at your side. This is in Jannah. How about on this earth? And therefore, we can say that the miracle of man and woman is something Allah clearly mentions in the Quran, that the two of you complete one another, the two of you are helpers of one another, that I created of his ayat is I created you from two genders, and the two of you will live together in peace and harmony, and of his miracles he has placed love and mawadda between you. So all of this is an indication of the importance of marriage, and something that our Prophet ﷺ has mentioned in many, many hadith. And also there is another wisdom that some scholars have mentioned of creating Hawa from the side of Adam. Creating Hawa from the side of Adam. Some scholars have mentioned that, and this is not Quran and Sunnah, but it is an interpretation, and there's no problem in mentioning these interpretations, that Allah created Hawa from the side of Adam so that Hawa can be protected. So that Hawa is basically like the rib cage, which is what protects you. He did not create Hawa from the head so that she can dominate Adam. Nor did he create Hawa from the foot so that he can dominate her. Rather, he created Hawa from the side where the heart is. And it is well known that the wife feels the most comfort and the most protected literally in the arms of her husband. That's where she feels the most comfort. And this is something that we can kind of derive even from this, that we created Hawa from the side of Adam. And Allah Azza wa Jal knows best. The final point we'll mention, because I don't want to go too much into other things, because we want some time for Q&A. And I'm going to skip over the whole story of Iblis, because that is something that we don't have time to really do right now. Which Jannah was Adam living in? Which Jannah was Adam living in when all of this occurred? Some minority of scholars have said that when Allah said that, وَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمُ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ, that by Jannah here is not meant the Jannah of the next life. It is simply meant a beautiful garden. This is an interesting interpretation that many of you have never heard before. And this was the position of, it has been attributed to Ibn Abbas, and Allah knows best. It has also been attributed to Imam Abu Hanifa, and it is the position of other scholars as well. And in fact, even Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, at one book of his, he seems to suggest this opinion. In another book, he suggests another opinion. So actually, he himself also has two opinions. And he says that, and the evidence that is used by all of these people, is, number one, there is no explicit evidence that it was actually the Jannah of the next life, because the word Jannah literally means a garden. And there are many evidences in the Quran where the word Jannah is used as a garden. For example, Surah Al-Kahf, when the person enters his Jannah, Jannatahu, this is his garden over here. Also in Surah Qalam, right? That there's a reference to a group of people with their Jannah. So Allah uses the term Jannah. So this position says that, okay, the word Jannah does not necessarily mean paradise. It could mean a garden. And number two, another thing they say is that Jannah will be forever. Whoever enters it will never leave. So how could Adam have left? How could Adam have left if Jannah is forever? And number three, they say that when Adam was created from this world and he was meant to be in this world, why then did he have to go up to Jannah and come back down? Rather, according to this opinion, it was a Jannah on earth. It was a Jannah on earth, a luscious garden somewhere that he lived for a while. Then he was expelled from that garden. And he was stripped away from the ease of just eating and whatnot, and then had to struggle in basically this world. Also, they say that Jannah is a place free of sin and evil. No regret, no remorse. How then could Adam have committed a sin in Jannah, then fallen in pain, when Jannah is not a place of pain and suffering? You see this point here, right? And they say that Iblis, how could he have entered Jannah? How could Iblis have entered Jannah and whispered to him when Iblis has been prohibited from entering Jannah? So this is an opinion. And the reason I mention this is you will actually find this in many books of tafsir. If it were some opinion that is not found, no need to mention it. But you will actually find it in some books of tafsir. The second opinion, and this is the vast majority opinion, and it is inshallah the correct opinion, is that it is the actual Jannah. It is the paradise. And this is the position of the bulk of scholars of the past and the present. And Ibn al-Qayyim, who is the main student of Ibn Taymiyyah, he strongly defends this point. And Ibn Taymiyyah, in another book of his, he also seems to defend this point. And they say, how do they explain the previous evidences? They say, whenever Allah says al-Jannah, it means that one Jannah. Every other Jannah is restricted, Jannatahu, Jannataka. Whenever Allah says Jannah and Al-Jannah, that is the Jannah of the next life. And also, Allah Azza wa Jal says, come down to this earth. اهبطوا منها, which means they were not on this earth. Allah says, come down to this earth, which means they were not on this earth to begin with. And also in Surah Taha, verse 116-119, the description of Jannah is that Jannah. إِنَّ لَكَ فِي أَلَّا تَجُوعَ فِيهَا وَلَا تَعْرَى. You'll never go hungry, you'll never go naked. وَأَنَّكَ لَا تَضْمَأُ فِيهَا وَلَا تَضْحَى. You'll never go thirsty, you'll never go tired. That is not a Jannah on this earth. That is the Jannah, the actual Jannah. And there are also explicit evidences as well that when the believers shall approach Jannah, they will find its doors closed. And they will go to Adam and they will say, oh, our father Adam, can you ask Allah to open the doors for us? And he will say, and has anything caused you to be expelled from it other than the mistake of your father Adam? I am not worthy of this. So they will then go to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he will make shafa'a to open the doors of Jannah. So this hadith is in Sahih Muslim. It is explicit that what did Adam say outside the gates of Jannah? I am the one that caused you to be expelled from this gate. Right? Explicitly he says this. So therefore, the correct opinion, inshaAllah ta'ala, is that Adam and Hawa were in the actual Jannah, which is the Jannah that is the paradise, and they were then expelled down to this earth. And inshaAllah ta'ala, with this, inshaAllah, and there's much more to be said, but time is limited, I will stop my benefits and leave the floor for you. And how will questions be asked?
Index cards later.
Index cards, okay. The